Tomorrow all the things were gone. I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
The Vietnam War was a long and growing conflict which lasted almost 20 years. 3 million people died, 58,000 of them being Americans.
With us here today is Vietnam veteran Joe Moyer. Thank you so much for taking the time to share your experiences with us. So Joe, tell us, what branch did you serve in?
United States Army.
We're honored to have Vince DiPrinzio, retired Marine Corps veteran, here joining us today.
Many brave men and women risked their lives to protect our country.
With us here today, Sergeant Jacob Torres. Thank you for coming and speaking with us today.
Thank you for having me.
Since our nation's birth, men and women have courageously served our country.
Here today with us is Mr. Herb Davis, a military veteran of the Vietnam War. Thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you for having me.
How are you?
1968, I was drafted 2 weeks after I graduated. And that was my first motorcycle. I left in November of 68, I'm sorry.
I was in high school when I joined the Marines, so it was just my parents and my brother at home. I decided to join the Marine Corps. I was a senior in high school because I wasn't sure what I wanted to do with my life. And we had the armed forces come to us February 1964 at our high school, talk to us, and I was, you know, kind of convinced to join the Marine Corps because what they said about discipline, and of course you'll see the world.
I was 18 years old, straight out of high school. Graduated high school, June 2010, July 2010, was off to basic training. School, I felt that college wasn't for me at the time. I didn't really want to go to college, and I was looking, I didn't have anywhere to pay for college, so I was looking for some way to pay for college. And the military offered those things, and I kind of wanted to do something different than my peers.
I was 19. I was in engineering school, and I wanted to serve the country. But I also wanted to get an education. And in order to do both at the same time, the Guard unit was the best answer at that time.
I served with the 101st Airborne Division.
United States Marine Corps, and like I previously said, he's the one convinced me because they were the best, which we still argue today with the Army, Navy, who's the best.
I'm a 68 Whiskey Combat Medic, or a healthcare specialist. The official term for the job is healthcare specialist, but we all call ourselves what our real job is combat medic. And that basically means we can work anywhere from a hospital to the front line.
I was in the United States Air Force. Started out at 177th Tactical Fighter Wing, which is the Air National Guard. And we were activated in 1967 because of the Pueblo. That was captured off the coast of Korea. And they activated the Air National Guard to fill in for the Air Force.
I love my job. ACIT, went here at ACIT. Health and Physical Sciences, that was my thing. I fell in love with medicine instantly, and it's been a thing ever since I joined high school. And I just decided to take that to the military.
That's a tough one because every day was a new experience. You never knew where you were going to be. You knew you were going to be on base, but you never knew where you were going to be and what task you were going to be assigned to. So you made the best of every day. And when you knew you were going to be there for a year, you were willing to do whatever it was to make the time go by. And because of that attitude, time did go by pretty fast now that we look back on it.
The people who I were attached to was a reservist MP unit, so there was like seven guys that I was attached to, and we really like grew as brothers. I still talk to them, some of them today, like saying, hey, how you doing? You know, we dealt with a lot of things from over that 9 month deployment, and just everyone there between the other nations, the people who are attached to, the civilian contractors, the interpreters, everyone. It was just a great experience.
I was drafted with a couple classmates, and one of them did get killed in action. William Godfrey. He was a helicopter gunner, which was shot down in October of 69. And another friend of mine just Friday died. There was a deal.
I made close friends over there, and I lost one. He was killed in action, I guess it was about 9 days after I got home, I found out. And he died on my birthday in 1966.
I believe we lost four soldiers and three civilians, like civilian contractors, and I helped out with that. Some of those images still stick with me today. That, you know, it's, I didn't know them, but they're wearing the same uniform I am. And I can only fathom how the people who are close to them feel, even to this day. It's terrible, it's awful. But you just gotta pick it up and drive on.
There were 58,912 men and women that died, lost their life fighting in Vietnam for American troops.
Many Vietnam veterans tell of the scrutiny of the war, how it really took a toll on them when they came back to America. What was the return like for you, and how did you handle the transition?
Well, I kind of snuck back into the country, I guess. I came home by myself, basically. And I had, as soon as I got back in the States, I took my uniform off.
I had an incident where the first morning I woke up in my own bed. My mom came in to pick up dirty clothes from the night before, and I told her basically to get out of the room. We weren't used to having people treat us with any kind of affection. You have to remember, the Vietnam War was a war that no one really was happy about. No war's happy, but especially the Vietnam War, because there were so many protests and protesters going on in the United States at that time, that when we came home, they told us basically to take and remove your uniforms and put on civilian clothes so that you don't get verbally and physically attacked in airports and in public places.
We were not respected coming home. We could not wear a uniform. We had things thrown at us. We were called different names I won't repeat. And this lasted, God, up until probably the late 90s, until people start recognizing us.
I mean, we've had incidents where people were actually spitting on the uniforms when the guys came off the aircraft coming home. And they were threatened, and every other possible comment was made to them. They called us baby killers because it really wasn't a war. It was a military action. Congress never really declared it as being a war like they did in World War I and World War II in Korea. So the whole atmosphere of the states was get out. You know, we want the war over, and we want our guys home.
It was tough. It's very tough. When you first get home, I got out of my car and just yelled at the top of my lungs, home. I'm so glad to be home. But that was only the beginning of the second battle of deployment. It's hard to turn off your military brain and go directly back to civilian life.
How did the military provide you with skills or prepare you for the rest of your life?
Teamwork. Working together, taking a task, setting it up, following through with it, and having a good understanding of what your goals are.
You know, if someone came into your house and told you how to live your life, then obviously you'd be a little disgruntled, right? So, patience. You gotta be patient with them, and I really took that in back into the civilian world and applied that with patience with everything.
I don't regret going over. I think a lot of people at least look into the military. Unfortunately, the wars take a lot of toll on people, but the military has a lot to offer.
You have to realize that the Vietnam War started in 1955. It ended in 75. So you have to understand that you guys, it was a whole generation. You weren't even, I was 8 years old when the war started, but yet at 22, I was in the war. So you have to look back on time and see where you were and understand what caused it, who kept it going, and it was a dramatic experience for each and every person that served. Over 5 million served in the war, and there were over 304,000 that came home injured or maimed in some way or other. So it affected a lot of people.
What was the most memorable part of the war for you?
Coming home.
And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men. Defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love.